Teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo fundamental teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo fundamental teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Today I'm reading Great Woman Disciples of the Buddha Visakha. The author is Helmut Hecker. This is part two of Buddha's Chief Patroness. Their implied meaning is as follows. 1. The wife should not speak ill of her husband and parents-in-law to others. Neither should their shortcomings or household quarrels be reported elsewhere. 2. A wife should not listen to the reports and stories of other households. 3. Things should be lent only to those who return them. 4. No article should be lent to those who do not return them. 5. Poor relatives and friends should be helped even if they do not repay. 6. A wife should sit in a becoming way. On seeing their parents-in-law or her husband, she should keep standing and not sit. 7. Before partaking of her meals, a wife should see that her parents-in-law and husband are served, and should also see that her servants are well cared for. 8. Before going to bed at night, a wife should see that all doors are closed and the furniture is safe, that the servants have performed their duties, and that her parents-in-law have retired. As a rule, a wife should rise early in the morning, and unless unwell, she should not sleep during the day. 9. Parents-in-law and husbands should be regarded as fire, and one should deal carefully with them as one would with fire. And 10. Parents-in-law and husband should be regarded as divinities. On the day she arrived in Savatthi, the city of her husband, Visakha was showered with various presents sent from people of all ranks according to their status and ability. But so kind and generous was she that she distributed them among the donors themselves with a kind message and treated all residents of the city as her own kinsfolk. By this noble gesture, she endeared herself to all the people of the city on the very first day that she came to her husband's home. There is an incident in her life which reveals her dutiful kindness even towards animals. Hearing that her well-bred mare had given birth to a foal in the middle of the night, immediately Visakha rushed to the stable with her female attendants bearing torches in their hands, and attended to all the mare's needs with the greatest care and attention. Her father-in-law, Megara, being a staunch follower of an order of naked ascetics, never invited the Buddha to his house for alms, even though the master frequently dwelt at a nearby monastery. Shortly after the wedding, to obtain merit, he invited a large company of naked ascetics for alms, whom he treated with deep respect and presented with fine foods. On their arrival, he told his new daughter-in-law, "Come, dear, and render homage to the arahants." Visakha was delighted to hear the word arahants and hurried to the hall, expecting to see Buddhist monks. But she saw only naked ascetics, devoid of all modesty, a sight that was unbearable for such a refined lady. She approached her father-in-law and retired to her quarters without entertaining them. The naked ascetics took offense and reproached the millionaire for having brought a female follower of the Aztec Gautama to his house. They asked him to expel her from the house immediately, but Megara, with much effort, managed to pacify them. One day, while Megara was eating rich rice porridge mixed with honey in a golden bowl, a Buddhist monk came to the house in quest of alms. Visakha was fanning her father-in-law. She stepped to the side so that Megara could see the monk and give him alms, but though the monk was in full view, Megara pretended not to notice him and continued with his meal. So Visakha told the monk, "Pass on, venerable sir, my father-in-law is eating stale food." Megara was furious at this remark and wanted to throw his daughter-in-law out of the house. But the servants, who had been brought to the house by Visakha herself, refused to carry out his order. The eight advisors to whom Megara complaint against Visakha was put concluded on examination of the matter that Visakha was blameless. After this incident, Visakha informed her husband's family that she would be returning to her parents. Megara asked her forgiveness and Visakha consented to stay on the condition that she would be permitted to invite the Buddha and the order of monks to the house. Reluctantly, he gave his consent, but following the advice of the naked Aztecs, he did not serve the monks personally. Just to be polite, he appeared shortly after the meal and then concealed himself behind a curtain while listening to the Buddha's sermon. However, the Buddha's words moved him so deeply that, while sitting there hidden from view, he penetrated the ultimate truth about the nature of existence and attained to stream entry. Filled with the overwhelming gratitude, he told Visakha that from now on onwards, he would respect her like his own mother, and accordingly he called her Megara Mata, which means mother of Megara. He then went up to the Blessed One, prostrated at his feet, and declared his allegiance to the Triple Gem. Visakha invited the Buddha for the next day's meal, and on that occasion, her mother-in-law too attained stream entry. From that time on, the entire family became staunch supporters of the Enlightened One and his community of monks and nuns. In course of time, Visakha gave birth to no fewer than 10 sons and 10 daughters, and all of them had the same number of descendants down to the fourth generation. Visakha herself lived to the remarkably high age of 120, but according to the commentaries, all her life she retained the appearance of a 16-year-old girl. This was the result of her merit and her enjoyment of the Dhamma, which filled her completely throughout the day. It is also said that she was as strong as an elephant and could work untiringly looking after her large family. She found time to feed the monks every day, to visit the monasteries, and to ensure that none of the monks and nuns lacked food, clothing, shelter, bedding, and medicines. Above all, she still found time to listen to the teaching of the Blessed One again and again. Therefore, the Blessed One said about her, "Visakha stands foremost among my women lay supporters who serve as supporters of the order." AN 1, chapter 14. Here is the quote of the day. "The universe itself is change, and life itself is but what you deem it. Everything changes, nothing remains without change." May every living being, our minds as one and radiant with light, share the fruits of peace, both heart of goodness luminous and bright. The people hear and see, now hands and hearts confide in giving unity, and their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness firm reward, may all who sorrow leave their grief and pain, may this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise, may all become compassionate and wise. Namo Fundamental Teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo Fundamental Teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo Fundamental Teacher Shakyamuni Buddha.